Australian outback. One of the harshest places on the planet to survive.
Well, if you hit a Brumby, it's goodbye to your car. You have cars breaking down, people stuck out there. Stop learning, you're dead.
If you're not self-sufficient, you just don't survive.
In this unforgiving environment, you wouldn't expect horses to thrive. But the Brumby is a special breed of horse. It is adapted to the desert, and with no natural predators, Brumbies are breeding out of control and creating problems for landowners trying to scratch out a living on this hard scrabble landscape. The local Australian horse wranglers and cattle station owners are becoming increasingly unable to control this problem. These self-sufficient, rugged individuals have been forced to reach for outside help.
That's it.
Mustering is pretty fun and dangerous.
Watch out for the bloody trees, Ian! Even though being out in the outback is extremely pretty, it can also be a really dangerous place as well. When you get a wild bull, you got to get him halter broke, and this is how you do it in the outback. Pretty much everything in this country is trying to kill you. You're galloping on horses, and you got a helicopter about, you know, 7 feet above your head, and you can feel the blade on the top of your head. You got to have your wits about you.
You've seen the flights of these guys. They are amazingly dangerous.
We're doing sometimes 60 or 70 knots to catch up with them. We can have anything from rocks going through the rotor blades, collisions with trees are quite common. Touch wood. We haven't had any fatals chasing horses yet, and we'd like to keep it that way.
Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
I'm Clinton Anderson, and I have a method for training horses. Getting horses to behave is simple. It's training people that's the real trick. Join me as I tackle some of the most challenging situations with problem horses and with problem owners.
Clinton Anderson's lifelong passion for horses started at an early age in Queensland, Australia. With the encouragement from his grandmother, Thelma Piercy, Clinton approached horsemanship with a single-mindedness and determination that would define his life. Clinton found early success in the sport of polo cross, where he was among the best in his age group throughout Queensland. But it was in training horses that Clinton found his true calling.
When he said he wanted to be a horse trainer, we sort of said, oh yeah, this is going to be good. You know, we weren't 100% thrilled about it, but I know I said to him one day, I said, well, why don't you go and do an apprenticeship for 4 years and have a think about it, and then you might want to come back and train horses. And he just looked at me and said, why do I want to waste 4 years of my life, Mum? And I thought, well, it's pretty damn true.
So, at the age of 15, Clinton packed up and headed off to apprentice for Gordon McKinley and then Ian Francis, two of the most revered horsemen in all of Australia.
I think we taught him to have a really strong work ethic and taught him to pay attention to the basics of horsemanship. He learned a lot about the foundation of horses in horse training. He learned a lot about keeping horses light and finesseful.
In my career, I've done a lot of work with wild horses. Like in Australia, Gordon and I broke in lots and lots of wild Brumbies, okay? And in the States here, I've handled, you know, lots of wild Mustangs as well, and work with, you know, general wild or problem horses in general. But what I hadn't done before is taken a horse from the wild environment straight to my hands without any interruptions or any intersection from anybody else. Meaning that, you know, like the wild Mustangs, they usually get captured, they get put into pens, they get fed for a few weeks, and then you might get your hands on them. So they have been domesticated a little bit, okay? And even in Australia, Gordon and I would get wild Brumbies to break in, but somebody had already captured them, loaded them on a cattle truck, brought them to me. So they were still wild, but they'd had a little bit of association with human beings.
World-renowned horseman Glennon Anderson is famous for his easy-to-understand method that gets results immediately with any horse. Now, you can get the ultimate tutorial of his method in a complete kit. Introducing Downunder Horsemanship's Fundamental Series. Glennon Anderson's signature method is packed with more practical training tools than any on the market today. He details his 8 steps to success, a dynamic and progressive format that makes even the most advanced maneuvers easy to understand and apply. The Glennon Anderson Fundamental Series kit includes 14 instructional DVDs with over 28 hours of brand new footage. Ground penning, groundwork, and riding topics are explored in greater depth and with more useful techniques than ever before. 15 arena mates containing step-by-step illustrations of the DVD lessons in handy pocket-sized booklets you can take to the barn and arena. Plus, you'll get Clinton's beautiful, perfect-bound philosophy book containing over 100 pages of insight and explanation of his method. This complete guide to the fundamentals of Clinton's training method comes packaged in a handy carrying case. Altogether, that's over $800 worth of training innovation, inspiration, and instruction. Now you can get the most in-depth horse training tutorial available for only $5.99. And if you're a No Worries Club member, the kit is yours for only $3.99. That's over $400 in savings. So act now. Restart your training program with all the latest tools for success with the Glennon Anderson Fundamental Series. To order, call or click 1-888-AUSSIE-2 or www.downunderhorsemanship.com.
In the Outback, survival of the fittest is no mere cliche. It is a daily struggle.
Out here, people die. You know, if you pull over on the side of the road for something gone wrong, if they don't know how to fix it, people can die. So we'll always give each other a wave, how you going? And you see somebody stop on the side of the road, you pull over and say, you know, you got a problem, you okay? 99 times out of 100, they are in the shit and they want something, yeah, done for them.
In the dry times, like there was a drought here in 2009, there was no grass and no vegetation within 30 miles of the permanent waterhole. So even though the large horses and camels were able to survive because they could bridge that gap between the waterhole and the feed grounds, the native animals can't travel those sort of distances, so they die out during those drought times and it takes them a long time to recover.
Well, out here, water is life or death. You have people down at the canyon falling over or going in there with one bottle of water and they don't make it. There's a medical centre down there. That's the only medical around for 300 kilometres.
There's not medical assistance around every corner out there. You're pretty much on your own. You know, you get hurt seriously, they have to fly a helicopter or a plane in there a long time to come get you. So you've got to take this stuff really seriously.
Many of the deadliest snakes and spiders in the world are found here.
You know, even though being out in the Outback is extremely pretty and just so much scenic energy around you, it can also be a really dangerous place as well. You know, Australia has the most venomous snakes, the most venomous spiders, you know, pretty much everything in this country is trying to kill you. You've got the camels, you've got the wild bulls, you've got the horses.
This is the King Brown or Mulga snake. Its technical name is Pseudicus australis. Sometimes they're perfectly brown. The desert form is speckled like this. Beautiful colour, beautiful snake.
The thing about the brown snake bite and the venom is that it contains neurotoxins and it infiltrates deep into the muscles where the nerves meet the muscles, and it destroys the transmission process from nerve to muscle, so you become paralyzed.
This is a snake that produces an awful lot of venom, and he bites and pumps it in. Toxin can destroy all of the muscles in your body over time if you're not treated.
These cobra-like snakes are milligram for milligram the most venomous snakes in the world.
If he bites you, he hangs on. He chews the venom into your ankle or your wrist, whatever has been bitten.
Right.
And that's what makes him so deadly, because he gets plenty of venom in.
Amid the harsh terrain and deadly animals lie some of the most beautiful landscapes on Earth.
The appeal would be the romance of the outback. It's the colours. The ranges change colour all the time. They're greens with all the trees. I mean, in good seasons, you can see it so lush, you would never think you're in an arid region. We've seen it with dust storms that take every leaf off every plant, and there's just nothing. So it's a really harsh environment, but it's also a very beautiful environment. You can't tame a man, and you can't tame the outback. You have to learn to live with the outback. You know, you have days here, you might have an influx of beetles. The next week it might be an absolute influx of the most smallest moths that get into everything. It's just bizarre. And it doesn't matter, even at their beautiful big resort, you'll see all these bugs running around, but you just live with it. You have to.
Not only is there dangerous animals in the outback, but just about all the vegetation wants to kill you as well. Like all that beautiful grass that you see, it's all got big long spikes on it. Okay? Every bush, every tree has got thorns on it.
Into this harsh and arid climate, domesticated horses, cattle, and camels were introduced in the 1800s.
Much of this country was pristine before Europeans came here. The landscape has just changed so much, particularly over the last 20 years since many of these areas were handed back to the Aboriginal people, and then no longer there was the management of feral animals in these areas. So the numbers have built up. On an average year out here, a feral horse population increases numbers by about 20% per annum. In the good years, like the last two summers, they've increased their population by 30% per annum. So it only takes 3 or 4 years for horse numbers to double in those good conditions. And yeah, that has a huge impact on the desert.
As people came and went, animals were turned loose. And instead of perishing in this difficult environment, they adapted and flourished.
Temperature here is sometimes 110, 115 degrees Fahrenheit. So that these brumbies in the desert, they're travelling over very, very hot country, and if they were to get dehydrated, they might lose the ability to keep their feet cool. And overheated feet, having to travel 40 kilometres to and from the feeding grounds and back to water, is sufficient to cause some long-lasting trauma. But these feet are still beautifully adapted to the conditions that are required to survive in this desert.
Now, with no predators remaining in this region, the Brumby population is growing by 20 to 30% per year, and their numbers are spiraling out of control.
It's created a horse that it's certainly a lot tougher. They're not particularly an athletic horse. You know, these horses are bred through natural selection to survive long periods of drought, to make the long treks at the walk between their water and their feed ground. You know, they're built quite heavy up front, they're quite stocky and they're very upright, but that allows that horse to be able to make those long treks and survive in this country. We haven't bred a pretty horse, we haven't particularly bred an athletic horse, but we've bred a horse that can survive in the desert.
Create
the ultimate training conditions with the Clinton Anderson Signature Series from Balin Country. The round pen, built to Clinton's personal specifications. We start with automotive grade high tensile steel and then use a premium finish to give you years of safe use. The arch gate features a durable and safe piston latch with a permanently mounted striker plate for easy opening and closing. Get the Clinton Anderson Signature Series from Balin Country. There is no other like it.
Downunder Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
The horses were introduced into Australia a long time ago in large numbers during the First World War, when a lot of the Australian light horsemen were actually riding horses into the war zones. But as time's gone on, the people in the outback have gone from horses to mechanised form of transport, mechanised form of mustering, and also to trapping rather than riding horses out into the wilderness and chasing cattle. Everything's fenced, a lot of yards are there, but horses have now escaped. They're now out there in large numbers. And as you're facing me, you're looking over the top of those ranges there. Beyond that range is estimated at 10,000 head of Brumbies running wild in that area at this time. Brumbies were horses that had been turned loose or went wild into different areas simply because they're a flight animal.
Brumbies in that particular area, the Brumbies are everywhere. In recent years, we've had three pretty good years out of a drought, so we've seen the horse numbers in that area explode. And, you know, the horse is a desert animal. He loves the desert, so this is just the perfect part of the world for a horse. And yeah, certainly the numbers have gotten quite large.
The large number of wild Brumbies has become a serious problem, creating chaos and destruction for local ranchers, as well as causing difficulties or even death for other animals that live in this region of the outback.
Well, we're losing stock all the time. They're jumping the fence, they're going into the neighbour's property. We lost 700 head of camels out of one of the paddocks here. They knocked it down and the camels are gone. They were in there for 6 months, then all of a sudden this Brumby got in there and they're all gone. I had an export ready for these camels to go overseas. Now I've got to go and do it again. I'm bloody upset.
If Brumbies or anything else goes through fences, it causes the farmer to lose money. A broken fence does mean a lot of lost revenue. My job now is looking after fencing and go out and patrol all the fence lines. There's a bloody lot of fence lines this afternoon. There's a couple of down near the truck yards that are broken down, so I'll be going out and repairing them. Wire cutters, barbed wire, pole bangers, all sorts of stuff. Get out there and repair it. We have a lot of problems with Brumbies and cattle breaking fences, and when they go through a fence, they'll clean up a couple of kilometres of fencing. So there's a broken wire for 300 or 400 metres at least. Restring it all and untangle it, put it all back together again. Yeah, real pain in the ass. With broken fences, the stock just goes straight through. Financial loss, you know, the stock gets across the road. If it's not branded or tagged, the farmer down the road gets to claim it. But yeah, these things happen.
Originally, the horses that came to this area were used for transport. They were farm type animals, and they've escaped or were released and became a feral population and increased in numbers within a radius of, say, 200 mile around where we are now at Kings Creek Station. There's 300,000 to 400,000 horses, you know, running wild in these areas. They have a huge impact on the native water sources here. So much so that a lot of the native animals, the important animals to the environment and also to the Aboriginal people that still live in this land, like the rock wallabies and the kangaroos, the emus, are now extinct from a lot of these areas, even where the permanent water holes are. And that's because the horses and the camels and the feral cattle drink that important water, but because they're going there every couple of days for a drink, they're feeding along the way in and they're feeding along the way out, and they just denude the area of vegetation.
And when we have large numbers of these animals concentrated on small water points, then the losers are the native animals. Now, we don't have big, robust native animals in Australia. We have marsupials, and they're the losers.
One of the big surprises when people come into horse country like this is the appearance of stallions. They're used to seeing geldings. Male horses in the domestic environment are all geldings. Rare for the public to see a stallion behaving with another stallion. I mean, they fight furiously. And so you come here and 50% of the population are all stallions. Their young ones are growing up, the old ones are busy trying to defend their mares. And the stallions, we've seen them defending their mares. They will challenge each other. They will invariably confront each other head on. And if they know each other, they'll know the strength of the other, and they'll display, they'll rear, they'll strike, and they'll mark their territory. And then generally, the standoff will finish and they'll move apart. And every now and then, there'll be a young buck who wants to take over, and it won't stop there. And they'll fight, and they'll rear, and they'll try to bite each other's knees, and they'll spin around and double barrel with their hind feet. And Dr. Hamsel and I have seen horses kick so hard that it looks like the shoulder's been broken, and the end of the battle will be there and then, because that horse will limp away and possibly die.
I guess we owe the European presence at least to the horses and the camels, because they brought European man from the coast and allowed them to settle in these areas, and they were important in developing this country. So we brought them here, and I guess we're responsible for them now as well. Unfortunately, they've run wild or feral in really large numbers.
The horses, like the camels, they're not native to Australia. The other thing they have in common with the camel is nothing eats them. So the only attrition that we can impose on these animals is through drought or aerial culling. And we haven't had any culls in recent years, and we've had successive good years in the desert with rain. So the horse is an animal that takes advantage of that, and their numbers have multiplied. And as a result, we have just far too many horses in concentrated areas. They're a hard-hoofed animal, so they do damage the environment.
The Brumbies are a problem when they're in large numbers, but we're horse people out here. We love horses. We don't want to see anything happen to them. We want to be able to muster them up and find some use for them, particularly the breed that was introduced into this area, which was the Whaler. But also at that same time, the Aboriginal stockmen of this country absolutely love horses. And so we want to be able to keep that action of their old grandfathers and forefathers before that, to be able to have this belief that the horses were one of the mainstays of the outback in this region in the early days.
But there's one wild Brumby in particular that has been especially destructive and has evaded all attempts to be captured. This rogue Brumby continues to damage Ian's property as well as his bottom line.
That rogue Brumby has been a problem to us for some time now, and all my men that work with me have had a lot of problems trying to get that horse back into the yard. He's been a bugger of a horse. He's actually been crippling a lot of our horses out in that area, and we've just wanted to try and get him back in.
We'll be right back with more from the Australian Outback, presented by Ritchie Industries. Well, Leon, here we are, mate, in the middle of the Outback, and this is the first official Ritchie Waterer to be in Australia in the Outback, correct?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Well, you know, it just stands to reason that Ritchie Waterers make the very best, toughest, most durable automatic watering system for all livestock. So if any waterer is going to put up with abuse, it's going to be a Ritchie Waterer, and that's what needs to happen here, because in the middle of the outback here, it's tough. You've seen the horses, you've seen the animals, you've seen the kind of abuse that everything goes on out here. You've got to have a waterer that puts up with it.
Well, we've seen a lot of abuse out here, but we have confidence that this water will hold up.
Yeah.
With its construction, polyethylene, plastic with the polyurethane insulation, it's rugged. I still haven't seen an animal out here that's going to tear it up.
This is the exact same water that I use on my ranch.
That's
every
correct.
Day. Well, Leon, we've talked a lot about Ritchie and what they do for the outback and the horses. Let's go out and catch some more wild Brumbies and get them trained, mate.
Sounds like a plan.
I've been in the outback all my life. The bush has been my home. I spent most of my life outside of Alice Springs on cattle stations, on cattle drives with my father. I started off as a young stockman many years ago. I was just an ordinary stockman that worked for my father. So I had a relationship with horses at a very early age. Since then, I have had quite a lot of opportunities to work with Aboriginal stockmen in rounding up Brumbies and selling them away from this country. I was born in Alice Springs to a part Aboriginal mother and a part Aboriginal father. Both of them were fluent in Aboriginal languages. My father spoke four languages, and he was a proper Aboriginal traditional man. He was also a great stockman. He was 52 years in the saddle. Most of his horses were rough horses. They didn't have any idea how to break horses in like the way they do it now. They just got on the buggers and rode them to a standstill.
The way I came upon Kings Creek Station was this was the only piece of vacant Crown land in the country, and that was in the 1970s. The government put out for expressions of interest in the land. I gave them a history of myself and how I would be able to manage this land, and I won the lease. Now, when Lynn and I came here, there was nothing here. There was no homestead, there was no road, there was no electricity and no water. And, you know, it was really Wild West. I mean, we lived under a tree for some time, no communication, and then we lived in a bit of a tin shed for some time. And in fact, we've only been living in a house since 2000.
When I came out here, I had to sort of learn a different way because you had to do without. If you'd run out of something, you just couldn't go down the shop.
We are 300 kilometres from Alice Springs if you were to take the shortcut road, as we call it, which is 100 kilometres of dirt.
I planned things a lot better now, but when I first came out, I mean, we lived on damper, which is a bush bread, which is cooked in a camp oven in the grounds, and kangaroos on the odd occasion would have meat, tin food. We never had refrigeration, so you just learn to adapt.
When you live in an environment like this where you're so isolated from everybody else, you have to be self-sufficient. All the water and electricity was connected by me. I laid the concrete floor for our shop back there with a very small cement mixer. The cost factor of living in these sort of conditions is astronomical. Like, you know, people quite often say, oh, my electricity bill for the month was $350. Ours is $350 a day. And so pumping water in this region is expensive as well. We spend something like $50 a day to keep our water supply up. So everything that you do is costly. If I'm going to build a tow bar or put something on a vehicle or fix something up or build a table or build a yard or whatever, I start with one piece of steel and I'll just design it as I go along. I can build practically anything, and it's just one of those things. You have to be self-sufficient to be able to do it. If you're not self-sufficient, you just don't survive. Within the region that we're in here now, we've got about 10,000 head of brumbies running wild. So we see brumbies on a regular basis. We've even got brumbies on our own property. What I'd like to see happen is that this brumbie is treated in a fair manner. We've proven that you can train these horses. They're very good riding horses.
Hi, Ian, I found this. This might help.
Oh, thanks, Lizzie. Clinton Anderson.
Okay, guys, remember, if you really want to get the horse light, you've got to pick up softly and release quickly, okay? The more bending and suppling you do, the lighter your horses will get. Huh. Hello.
Hello. Is that Clinton Anderson?
Yes. Yes, this is Clinton Anderson. Who am I speaking to, mate?
Oh, this is Ian Conway. I'm calling you from the outback of Australia. It's actually in the middle of nowhere. We're southwest of Alice Springs, in the vicinity of Ayers Rock. We're on a cattle station.
Okay, mate, well, you've got my attention. What's on your mind today? When Ian called, I was very intrigued, to say the least. You know, I haven't had a call like that ever.
Clinton, look, I've been reading in magazines, and I've also spoken to one of my friends in relation to your horsemanship in the United States, and I was just wondering whether I might be able to talk to you about a few things.
Okay, mate, tell me more about it.
You probably don't know it, but I live in country where there's a lot of brumbies. I mean, thousands of brumbies running wild.
Well, that's a hell of a lot of brumbies.
And we have a lot of problems with brumbies from time to time, which we can handle, but in this situation, we have a problem with a brumbie that has been giving us trouble for quite a long time. We can't catch the bugger. So we need somebody that's very good at horsemanship. So I was just wondering whether you might be able to think about getting down here sometime.
I thought, well, maybe this is a practical joke, you know, initially, because it kind of sounded pretty far out there. You want me to come to the middle of the outback in Australia and help you capture a wild rogue brumbie stallion that's causing you a bunch of problems. Have I got the story right, mate?
This is the challenge. I want you to track this animal. I want you to capture this animal. I want you to bring him back here, and I want you to break him in.
Then you want me to break it in, get it quiet, train it,
And when you break him, I want to be able to put one of my kids on him and they ride out of the yard on the back of this animal. That's what I want you to do, mate.
From my perspective, it wasn't just the horse training part, it was the business aspect of it as well. You know, for me to come over and do this, this is not a small feat. This is going to take a lot of time on my effort and my company's effort, and I just can't make a decision right now. But I tell you what, it's very intriguing. I'm always up for a challenge. I like to challenge the method. I like to challenge my own horsemanship skills as a horseman. And so let me give us some thought, okay? I'm not going to say yes or no, but let me give us some thought. Let me talk to my managers and we'll see what we come up with.
Give us a ring back when you've got time and we'll talk to you some more about it, okay?
I'll talk to you in a few days, okay, Ian?
Righto, cheers.
Righto, mate. Thanks for your call, mate. See ya. Huh. Well, you don't get that every day.
Anything worth having is worth working for, that's for sure.
Not gonna make it here if you got any quit in you.
This is where I needed to be the best that I could be. And that's just what we do here.
Dedication, ambition, passion. To some, these are more than ideals. They are a lifestyle, a code, a path to something greater. If you think you're one of the select few who can rise to the challenge, who can dedicate themselves to mastering the method through 70 weeks of in-depth, hands-on training, let the Clinton Anderson Academy catapult your skills and provide you with the ultimate experience. If you have what it takes, become a Clinton Anderson Certified Clinician and change your life.
Downunder Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
You know, when I was doing my research after I got Ian's initial call, you know, I took this very seriously. I wasn't just going to jump on a plane with all these people and equipment and go do this without knowing where I was going. So I did my research on Ian, and I felt really comfortable after I really researched him quite a bit. You know, he's an absolute true bushman. He's lived in the outback his entire life. He studied horses, he studied camels, he's very familiar with the local Aboriginals. In fact, he's part Aboriginal himself. You know, I felt really comfortable I was going with someone legit. He lives, breathes, and eats the outback. Heck, they lived under a tree for the first, you know, 4 or 5 years they were out there. So I knew I was with somebody that could help guide us in the right direction. I knew if I could get my hands on the horse, I felt confident I could get my job done. What I wasn't sure about is could we even capture him in the first place? Because, you know, Ian couldn't get that done either.
Ian Conway speaking.
Hey mate, it's Clint Anderson here, how are you?
Oh, g'day Clinton, how you going mate?
Good. Well listen Ian, I've been giving it quite a bit of thought about our last conversation and I've done some more research and talked to my team and my managers and looked at my calendar and I gotta say I'm kind of excited but I'm gonna take this challenge on mate.
Oh. That's fantastic news.
This is going to be very exciting. It's going to be an adventure at the same time and something very, very challenging for me and the method and the company. And so you're going to be seeing me real soon.
Well, as you say, it's going to be a challenge, mate. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, coordination is going to be a big thing. For us to do this correctly, we've got to have all the helicopters, the horses, the personnel, everybody to get this horse captured. And then I have to have enough time to work with
it. Look, this horse has been giving us so much trouble for so long that we'd really like to see this horse broken into a standard where, you know, kids can ride it if you're up to that challenge, that is.
Depending on how old he is and how bad he is and how aggressive he is going to, you know, take time to see how long it's going to take for us to actually get a handle on him. I'm always looking for ways to challenge myself as a horseman. I'm always looking for ways to challenge the method.
I want you to break this horse in so that we can almost walk between his back legs when he's standing still.
It's certainly a challenge and I'm up for it, mate. There's no better way to challenge it than with a wild stallion that's never been captured before, that lives out in the middle of Australia in the rankest part of the country, and you know, run him in and capture him and train him with the method. Listen, we'll be in contact, we'll start working out all the details, and this is gonna be an adventure. I hope you're ready for it, mate.
The mares are in season now. I don't want this horse jumping any of them at this stage. We want to tame this horse and make sure that we've got him in the yards back here so the kids can handle it.
No worries. Listen, take care of yourself, mate. We'll be in contact.
All right, mate. Cheers.
Bye.
Thank you.
I thought to myself, if I can do this as a horseman and the method can do this, that's just another testament of how good the method really works. It will work on any age of horse, any breed of horse, now any country, any continent, any wildness, it will work on. So I accepted the challenge.
Well, mate, we're at DFW getting ready for the Outback adventure. We're going to get on the plane and then we're going to get ourselves some wild brumbies, mate.
The travel was an adventure by itself and very brutal. I kind of underestimated how much wear and tear it would take on me just to even get there. It's a 3-hour flight from Dallas to LA, okay? Then you've got 14 hours from LA to Sydney. And then another 6 hours from Sydney to Alice Springs.
Well, mate, here we are, 20 plus hours of traveling, and we're here in Alice Springs in the outback in Australia. I can't wait to get my hands on these wild brumbies, start training them, and starting this adventure.
Then another 5-hour drive from Alice Springs to King Canyon. And we did this completely straight the whole way through.
Well, Alan, we've been driving out here for hours, mate. I haven't seen anybody. Is this pretty typical?
Pretty typical, yeah. But you don't see anybody, and yeah.
This is the furthest I've ever been in the middle of the country. Like, this is really out there.
Yeah, it's a long way from anywhere. Yeah. We're about 300 k's from the closest town, but it's sure a bloody beautiful country.
Tell me something. Is there a lot of accidents with animals on the road?
Yeah. We won't drive at night time unless it's absolutely essential. The horses will come out and just merge in with the road, and people wreck their cars. We had a bus hit a cow not long ago. Driver broke her arm.
What about camels?
Camels will come out, yeah, they'll lie on the road for the heat. You don't see them until you're right on top of them, and it's too bloody late.
Yeah.
Two people got killed over near the rock a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Hit two camels at the same time.
What about breakdowns, mate?
No AAA out here, no. It's fix yourself.
Yeah.
Talking about breakdowns, we've got a little problem here, we have.
What's the problem, mate?
Temperature gauge is up and red light's on, so the alternator's not charging, so I think we might have done a fan belt.
Right, mate.
We'll have to pull over and just have a sticky at this.
Right, but it's not too serious.
Well, we'll see if we can fix it. My first experience with this, I called it at a farmer's place and borrowed a set of stockings off the farmer's wife and got home with a broken fan belt.
Righto, let's see what happens.
Let's see how we go.
Driving to Kings Creek Station where we were there, then we broke down. You know what I mean? So when we broke down at that point, I'm just about ready to jump off the bridge.
One thing about it, she's not too hot. I caught it in time.
Right.
So it doesn't look too bad. Just let me have a better sticky. Nah, bloody alternator bracket's broken.
Okay. Is that something we can get fixed here, mate?
I reckon I might be able to fix that. I think I saw a couple of washers in the back of Ian's car, so right. I might be able to just sandwich them together and should be pretty right. Just give us a second.
I'm glad I got Alan around because I can guarantee you I'm not a mechanic's bootlace.
And yes, I was right. Look at this. Just what we bloody need. I can fix this. I reckon Ian might have been bloody saving those washers for the bloody parking meters in Alice. Bloody bit of a tight ass he is.
So if it's something major, mate, do you just radio in? What do you do if it's something major but you can't fix in a hurry?
We have satellite phones out here, so it's just a matter of waiting until we pick up signal and we can dial Ian and he can come out and pick us up.
I reckon that's fixed.
Righto, Alan, good job, mate.
Right, no worries, thank you. Right, I reckon we can head off now.
Righto, let's
get
going. We've got stuff to do.
We got it fixed and Alan got us back on track again, but I was close to committing suicide. Being out in the middle of the outback, you got to be self-sufficient. And that's one thing that I really noticed about Ian and Alan and all the people that live out there. You know, you just don't call the local mechanic when something goes wrong or the handyman. You are the handyman. You are the local mechanic. They build just about everything they use there. You know, they're very efficient with their hands, their minds, and if there's a way that something's broken that they can get it pulled back together, you can guarantee these guys will figure it out.
This is the Watermatic 150. It's all plastic, very tough. In fact, this stuff is so tough, the horses can kick it all day and they're not gonna hurt it. And with this nice soft edges, it's not going to hurt the horse. You pull the cover off, there's no tools necessary, just pull it off with your hands. And to adjust the water level, you just do it with this wing nut. You loosen it, adjust your level to where you want it, tighten it back up. This is probably one of our easiest units to clean because all you have to do is you pull the drain plug out, You stick it in this other hole, it's the same size, and you just wash it off. You can also use that feature to close off one side. If you just want, you just have a horse on the other side, you want to keep this side clean, pull the plug out, stick it in there, and away you go. Like most of our units, they have built-in pocket for the hold down, so you can bolt that down into the cement. Another nice feature about this cover is our water groove design. In the winter, we tell people to either fill it with water or vegetable oil, and that creates a seal. Instead of using a gasket, if it freezes in the winter, every time you pull it off, that gasket's going to rip apart. We also have a unit that has one side, and it does essentially the same thing as the 150.
The Watermatic is an extremely versatile unit. It doesn't come standard with heat, so it's ideal for areas that do not necessarily have to buy the extra heat package to keep it open during the winter. But it also keeps it cooler in the summer because it is fully insulated.
If you want to find out more about the Watermatic series or any of our other products, go to richiefountain.com or richieequine.com.
You must be in.
G'day, mate.
Clint Anderson, good to meet you, mate.
Good to meet you, Clint.
I tell you what, I've traveled a long way to get out here. You are in the middle of nowhere.
Closest place to any beach in Australia.
Well, listen, thanks, mate. I tell you what, it sounds like you've got some problems going on out here.
Yeah, we have. We've got a Brumby rogue that's been running this country for a long time. Yeah. He's about 10 years old.
Yeah.
He's given us a lot of trouble. We've been chasing him for years.
What's he doing? What kind of trouble?
Oh, he's knocking fences down, kicking shit out of all our horses.
Yeah.
And it's really been a real problem. He's also even desecrating the water holes and stuff, you know, that these old Aboriginal fellas wanted. He's taken all his herds into those and those sort of things. So the whole place is just going to ruin.
Right. So you want, the goal is we've got to capture him. And we've got to relocate him. We've got to get him broken and just get him out of here.
Yep.
And you think things will go back to normal when that's happened?
I think so, because he's been the main one that's given us all this trouble. So as soon as we get rid of him,
And you've been trying to catch this horse for a while?
10 years.
10 years.
Yeah, 10 years.
That's not good. Yep. Okay. Well, before we go after him, let me see what kind of damage he's been after.
Okay, mate.
This was way out there. I mean, we were in the middle of nowhere. Where we went made the outback look like civilization. That's how remote we were. We were 7 hours from the nearest doctor. There's no internet, there's no cell phones. It's pretty much you and the wild animals. The horses are wild, the women are wilder, and the men are scared. You know, it is way out there. I'd never been this far out in the middle of the outback, and most people in Australia have not been there either, mainly because nobody knows how the hell to get there. And it's just really rank. It's kind of like on the movies like the Old West, like Last Frontier. I mean, it's dangerous. There's a lot of wild animals out there, a lot of wild snakes, spiders, you name it, it's probably gonna kill you. And it's pretty remote out there. You know, you could drive 10, 12 hours and never ever see a car. I thought it'd be interesting for me to go there. And I also wanted to kind of share this with our viewers. You know what I mean? This is something extremely unique. What I was sure about was my ability and the method. I knew it would be difficult, but I was confident in myself and very confident in the method that it would tame a 10-year-old wild stallion. But what I was unsure about was, could we even get him captured to begin with? You know, this wasn't the first time that this horse had tried to be captured. Ian had tried several times and failed. Other people had tried and failed. So I thought to myself, man, if he's already failed, what hope do I have?
Let me show you what this bloody damage is all about here, mate.
Righto, mate. It wasn't until I got there in the middle of the outback with Ian and he took me out and showed me the damage that's being caused to the properties.
Look at this bloody gate, look.
The fences, the pastures, etc.
We'll have to get Alan onto this to get it fixed again.
It wasn't until that happened that things really started to sink in for me.
Yeah, you can see what's actually taken place here. We've had to replace quite a lot of this stuff with mesh to stop him from going through. You can see the wire all broken on the inside there. Cable's broken. He's been a real pain in the ass. He's been in this yard, but he's taken the whole yard out, so we've lost him.
So, and you said he wants to fight with other stallions?
All the time. You can't have any other horses around him. He's a bugger to fight all the time.
Right. Ian was not exaggerating. When he spoke to me on the phone about how this stallion and the horses are causing a lot of problems, it was exactly what it was, okay?
See, this is what I've been talking about. See how they knock all these panels and stuff out? You get this horse in the yard with a bunch of mares and a bunch of stallions, and what do? They just go straight through it. This bloody Brumby stallion is the worst horse we've ever handled, and he's knocking bloody fences down all over the place. And obviously, he's gone through here in the last few days. We're patching fences all the time.
Yeah, because he's just tearing them all down.
He is. And knocking panels out, you know, all the rails on the fence, he's jumping them and breaking them, so over the period of time, he does a lot of damage.
He had a big problem on his hands, you know what I mean?
Well, we're losing stock all the time. They're jumping the fence, they're going in the neighbour's property. We lost 700 head of camels out of one of the paddocks here. They knocked it down and the camels are gone. We, you know, they were in there for 6 months, then all of a sudden this Brumby got in there and they're all gone.
Yeah.
Not a bloody sign of them.
That's a lot of money.
It is a lot of money. Well, I had an export ready for these camels to go overseas.
Yeah.
Now I've got to go and do it again.
Yeah. So it's a major pain in the neck and it's costing you thousands of dollars. I can see why you're pretty upset about this.
Yeah, I am. I'm bloody upset.
When fences are getting ripped down from the horses, wild camels, that type of stuff, it costs thousands and thousands of dollars to fix it, get those animals back, etc.
Well, we've got a dam in there, and obviously he's come back sometime and knocked the fence over to get a drink because he's been fenced right out of all the other yards at the moment.
Yeah.
But he's obviously come back in here and he's knocked the fence over and he's got a drink out of that dam just there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
And you're constantly repairing this kind of stuff?
Constantly. Yeah, they knock the fences down here and then they get in the dam there and they drink. It's a rainwater dam, so we don't really want horses in there all the time.
Not only were we having an adventure, testing the method, testing me as a horseman, but we were actually doing something to help him and the other people that live out there to help their living get reestablished. What was unique about this challenge was that this horse was literally gonna go from never being around mankind before, completely wild, completely rank, to my hands immediately. So that was, to me, gonna raise the level of difficulty quite a bit because there was no time for him to get desensitized or used to human beings, but I was very excited to do the challenge. Nobody's ever done this before, you know, in the world. Nobody's ever gone to such a remote location, captured a 10-year-old wild stallion and decided, hey, let's start it and see if we can tame it. But, you know, where we went was very, very remote.
Under Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure has been brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
A call from Ian Conway has brought me to the Red Centre of Australia for a challenge that I don't know if I can accomplish. And now it's showtime, mate.
Wild Brumbies in the Outback, mate, they can easily travel 20 miles a day in search of wood.
Wood.
Fuck it. Well, it's 10 past two, mate. When's the plumber showing up? Are you supposed to look at your watch? What time is it?
I don't know, Clint.
Well, what do you know? It's a damn Ritchie water in the middle of the Outback. Let's get some, mate.
That's the biggest load of bull I've ever heard in my life.
Who is this crazy old